Hello, everyone. I'm Jim Garrison, and I want to welcome you to our January Chartres community call as we commence the year 2023. For those of you who are new, that collage of images and sounds was from our last pilgrimage to Chartres in August of last year, where about 90, 95 of us gathered in that sacred place to honor the divine feminine and to consecrate ourselves to a more robust and abundant humanity through an adoration of the sacred feminine. Apela, Colorado could not be with us today for our usual invocation. She's flying to Costa Rica. So I want to just bring in the blessings of the earth today. The blessings of our sacred ecology, our mother, and the cosmic forces that have created such a beautiful world. May we, in this time of turbulence, in this time of uncertainty and chaos, dive deep into our inner selves to find our connection with life and find our connection with love, and through love to find our connection to community with one another. We convene these calls every month as we prepare each year, as we've done for 17 years now, since 2006, to make pilgrimage to one of the most sacred places in the world, a site just west of Paris that has been memorialized for thousands of years as a site where the telluric energies have a particular intensity and frequency that calls up in the human psyche and soul the sacred feminine. And so each year we make pilgrimage to Chartres. We spend 7 days there and we explore one of the seven liberal arts. Last year we explored rhetorica, which is about how we manifest love and purpose in our words and our deeds. This next year, we're going to be delving into the fourth of the liberal arts, into musica, the liberal art that Pythagoras, who originated the liberal arts, felt was the sacred heart of all the liberal arts. Emanating out of the sun, the music of the spheres that harmonized the entire solar system into a unity and harmonized life on Earth into an integrated whole. So this next year, we're going to be delving into the music of the spheres as a pathway to deeper love and healing. One of the characteristics of the Chartres Academy and the Chartres community is our deep belief in the larger astrological attunement of the universe in which humanity arose, has its being, and returns. So each community call and each year in Chartres, we seek to honor the astrological significance of our time. So in that spirit, as we begin our program today, I want to welcome back Lynn Bell, who is one of the original faculty in Chartres starting back in 2006. And each month she attunes us to what we need to pay attention to coming out of the planetary alignment. So Lynn, as we begin 2023, speak to us about what's going on out there.
Well, this is a long conversation, and as you know, I'll be offering something on the entire year on January 21st. But for today, what's really important is that Mars, which has been retrograde for quite a long time, on the 12th, it stations and it starts to go forward again. And this is a very long process that's been going on since September, where if it feels that what you're doing isn't effective, or your energy is dispersed in more than one direction, or all kinds of challenges have come to meet you, which is, I think, how it feels for many people. I mean, you can just see that in the world, getting forward, moving, getting traction has been incredibly difficult. If we look at certain political situations, for example, that there's this notion that nothing is easy. And all of a sudden, this long process of being inward and being in some ways of two minds, being of having more than one path to walk, it is, there are choices, there's something that drops in and reactivates our movement and our intention. And what is wonderful is that tomorrow, Venus, who in many ways offers her elegant hand to Mars to dance, comes and makes an extremely harmonious, a friendly relationship to this Mars just before. So it's like, ah, oh, at last. That is now, at the same time, most of you are familiar with Mercury retrograde, which is still going on. And it has, so there's one step forward, something's moving forward, but not everything, not 100% yet, not until about the 19th of January. And the 19th of January is the day the sun conjuncts Pluto. So there's this incredibly powerful insight available to all of us. We're stepping into the energy of this month is very alive, very vital, very fiery, very, we want to come together and find what will bring us to the center. There's this shift in who leads and what leads in our lives, how we actually move forward, and what moves in front, what takes precedence, what is stepping out in front of everything else. Because it's, as we've talked about over the past several months, there's been a split in deciding which side of us is taking the lead. So in theory, we're entering a period where something has coalesced internally, and whatever has come to terms for all of you, whatever has come together for all of you over this holiday period with the powerful full moon that we had just a few days ago, whatever has come together for you is getting ready to step out into the world. We're not on hold. The past 2 years, we began the year holding our breath. And this time we can say, yes, let's go. So I want to encourage all of you to go towards what you desire, to really sit with what's pulling you in different directions, bring them together, and really hold, really look at what you want and make an engagement. Make an engagement to move towards it, to take the leap, to cross the water, to come together. There's very important things going on this year. Pluto is going to change signs for the first time in a long time, 15 years, not completely, but briefly. And I'll be talking about that more in the next two meetings. But there is some very, what is being done in chart, the way we come together from all over, the way Jim has brought Humanity Rising together. These are incredibly important endeavors of how people are linked. And this is going to become more and more powerful in the time to come. And it's really wonderful. We are all here as part of one of these endeavors. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn, so much. I love this point that you're ending with, that, you know, it's these communities, these networks of intention that are being created, that are of singular importance, I think, in our world of escalating turbulence, as oases that enable us to rest and gain solace and a fortitude for what we all have to navigate as the world unfolds. So thank you so much for that. And Georg put the link, everyone, in the chat for Lynn's workshop on the 21st. Every year for the past several years, Lynn has done a workshop, about a two and a half hour workshop in January, so that all of us can just look at the year, understand the calendar of the skies, and be made more wise thereby, so that we attune ourselves to some of the planetary alignments that have such profound impacts on our attitudes and behavior. So thank you so much, Lynn.
You're welcome. And I'm not staying. I'm really looking forward to it. And there's a lot to step into this year. So I hope you'll join me. And I won't be staying on the call today, but I'm sure it'll be wonderful. Much love to all.
Right. Bye-bye. And now, everyone, I'd like to introduce my good friend, Banafsheh Sayyad, who will introduce our speaker today. Musica is under the aegis of the sun. Each one of the liberal arts has a planet. And Musica is under the aegis of the sun and the philosopher Pythagoras. And I'll be talking about Pythagoras in some of our subsequent community calls, but we have a cosmologist that's going to be talking about the sun today, and Banafsheh will be introducing her in just a moment after making some introductory remarks. Banafsheh, welcome. I turn the program over to you.
Thank you. A blessed new year to you, everyone. As I've given updates on events in Iran in these gatherings, I'd like to give you a brief update. The Islamic terrorist regime in Iran continues to commit unspeakable atrocities as it can sense its own demise. It continues to arrest innocent protesters. People are being arrested for simply speaking their minds, women for not covering their hair in public, men for giving flowers to women who don't cover their hair in public, people for teaching how to cook a certain dish, for doctors were treating protesters injured by the regime's forces, interviewers who have interviewed Mahsa Amini's parents, you name it. The regime is arresting anyone who even remotely shows signs of being a free thinker. But not just arresting people, hitting them, torturing them, drugging them, raping them, killing them, hanging them, if they're not already shot dead on the streets for non-violently protesting, asking for their basic human rights. Just yesterday, two men were hanged, two innocent protesters who were not given a fair trial, who had no rights to lawyers, Muhammad Mehdi Karami and Muhammad Husseini. I urge you not to remain silent about these atrocities, as injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere, as Martin Luther King Jr. says. Yesterday was a tragic day, but also a beautiful day. The birthday of our beloved Jim Garrison. Happy birthday, Jim. Now I'd like to turn the mic over to Kala Perkins, who is a cosmologist par excellence. She blends the creative arts and psychology with astrophysics and environmental science. Kala has a master's in environmental science, bioethics, and a master of divinity and interfaith chaplaincy. Kala is currently completing her doctorate in astrobioethics and continues teaching meditation and mindfulness as well as astronomy to both students in schools and to adults at the Science, Philosophy and Humanities Nexus. Kala, tell us about the sun.
All right. Good morning, everyone. First, Banafsheh, I have to take a moment in my heart to acknowledge the depth and the profundity of what you've shared with us. It's our hearts are here and holding whatever we can to the depth of the reality of the situation and visioning the future of harmony and peace. Thank you. So I am going to screen share, and I also have here an acknowledgement of our beloved Jim's birthday. I did a brief web search for the most beautiful Hubble image, and it came up with Happy Birthday Hubble Space Telescope, which was appropriate. It's the Cat's Eye Nebula. So happy birthday, Jim. We're so grateful for you. And now where we will go is to our sun. And I also want to acknowledge Lynn's beautiful thoughts about this year and the full moon we just had. It was Cancer and Capricorn. Cancer is the cosmic mother, Capricorn, the earth mother. So we are being held in this year with the opening of the cosmic mother. All right, the sun, our home star. I want to share with you, I posted this image, this beautiful image of the smiling sun that is actually literally a photograph from NASA. It is not a poster that someone created. It's literally these coronal holes, magnetic field holes going into the sun. That is the picture that NASA took of the sun. It looks to us, of course, like a smiling sun, but it is really the image of our sun very recently. All right, so I'm going to try and move this image here. Can you all see it well? I can't hear anyone?
Yes,
okay. We can, yes.
Okay. Off we go. Okay, so we'll move this there. So the heliophysics observatory system, these are all the many satellites that we've created since the 1960s to try and understand our sun and the atmosphere between us and the sun and how the sun influences our planet. We will do this. All right, these are the current missions, some of the current missions to the sun, Voyager, Parker, SOHO, and they have such beautiful images and they're all available for the public to see. We just passed perihelion, which is the closest time the Earth is to the sun, on January 4th. Apihelion will be 2 weeks after the June solstice. So how did our solar system form? Science tells us the sun and the planets all formed together 4.6 billion years ago from a cloud of gas and dust called the solar nebula. A shockwave from a nearby supernova exploded, probably initiating the collapse of the solar nebula. Sun forming at the center, planets forming a thin disk around it. In the same manner for each planet, their moons and the comets formed in the outer solar system, many thrown out to great distances, forming the Oort cloud. And after the sun ignited, a strong solar wind passed through the solar system, throwing out the extra gas and debris. So that is what science tells us. However, We know Mysterium Cosmographium and Harmonious Mundi from Kepler. There is geometry in the humming of the strings, and there is music in the spacing of the spheres. So it seems to me, certainly, that each sun, each star sings the planets and itself into orbit in its dust cloud by its own inherent harmonic identity. This is what was understood by the ancients. It's certainly what seems logical and what we're beginning to understand in terms of physics as well. This wonderful set of formula was created by Michael Banks and Nicholas Scafetti. It is a recent article, Scaling Mirror Symmetries and Musical Consonances Among the Distances of the Planet in the Solar System. I highly recommend it. So we have our solar system, and each of our major planets, the big planets, have their own whole systems. Jupiter with 79 or more moons, Saturn 82 moons, and our planet, of course, with its one moon. So the sun's closest neighbor, it's Alpha Centauri and Proxima Centauri. It's actually a three-star system. It's about 4.3 light years away. And these are beautiful pictures from our telescopes of those, our nearest stellar neighbors. So where are we? This is the galaxy. This little ring here is where the sun moves around. These are graphic images of the sun moving around in the solar system. The Earth moves 30 kilometers around the sun in a single second. Our solar system oscillates, spinning 200 kilometers per second around our galaxy inside its outer spiral arm, approximately every 230 million years. Oops. The Milky Way galaxy spins approximately 210 kilometers per second, 600 kilometers per second within the local group. So if anyone ever tells you that you don't know how to dance or that you're not dancing, tell them they don't know. So this is, of course, our Milky Way, the beautiful arc that we are embedded in two-thirds of the way out from the center of our galaxy. This is our Milky Way, and Andromeda is our nearest neighbor. That's our local group. So what is the sun made of? The sun is a giant nuclear reaction. It's cooking, turning hydrogen into helium in its core. It's a huge glowing sphere of hot gas. Most of the gas is hydrogen, 70% helium, about 28%. Carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen make up 1.5%. The other 5% only is small amounts of elements like neon, iron, silicon, magnesium, and sulfur. All this stuff that we're made of was cooked up in some two or three or four generations of stars living and dying and exploding to make our solar system and the planet that we abide on. All this stuff is ancient stardust. And we know this. This beautiful spectrum tells us the elements in the sun with spectroscopy. So every ray of the sun is luminous solar music, singing its elemental nature to everything it touches. We can think about that as we go out into the sun and feel its beautiful caress. Excuse me. So the solar structure, this huge ball of hydrogen and helium, is held together by its own gravity. It has many regions, the core, the radiative zone, the convective zone. Excuse me. Moving out, then we have the visible surface, the photosphere, then the chromosphere, transition zone, and the corona, which is much, much hotter than anything except the core of the sun. The corona is more than a million degrees, even though the surface is only 10,000 degrees, relatively speaking, because of the dynamic activity of the sun. The solar cycle, known as the solar magnetic activity cycle or sunspot cycle, is a nearly periodic 11-year change where the sunspots begin at the poles of the sun and move toward the center and then flip the magnetic field of the sun. And this happens every 22 years, the cycles flip and then turn back to its original state. So the sun is extremely active and dynamic. This is in ultraviolet light at solar maximum. And we see all of these sunspots that have converged in the belly of the sun in the equatorial area. And this is real time. These are real images of the sun. So NASA, the difference between coronal mass ejections and solar flares. So the sun is pouring out these masses of energy in like its own musical dynamic. The clouds are particles, they're hurled out into space. It takes about 1 to 3 days for them to reach the Earth, whereas the flares are giant bursts of X-ray energy that travel at the speed of light, taking 8 minutes to reach the Earth. So we are bathed in all of this dynamic activity of the sun. We live and move and breathe in the plasm, the energy, the pulse and the music of the sun. The ones here on the bottom and up in the corner here, the left corner or the right corner, depending on how you're seeing, those are coronal mass ejections, and these up here are solar flares. The solar flares cause geomagnetic storms with aurora in the northern and southern reaches. So how this happens is the energy flows from the sun, and it impacts the magnetic field of the Earth. It causes disruptions in the field between these two magnetic fields, and all of these particles are directed by our magnetic field toward the poles, protecting the whole surface of the Earth. So it's 93 million miles away. So in 1989, Quebec had a huge geomagnetic storm that impacted it such that it knocked out for 9 hours all of the power grid of Quebec. And this can happen. We thought it would happen again in December 2020, but it calmed down on its way. With the International Space Station, we see the beautiful enveloping lights of the aurora, the electromagnetic energy coming from the sun, this plasm here and above in the red. So this is Earth's magnetic field lines here that protects us and directs all of these ions, the particles, toward the poles that we see. And the core of our Earth, just like the core of the sun is creating its magnetic field, the core of our Earth is creating our magnetic field. So sunspots, these are these brilliant coronal holes that open in the sun that start at the equator and go toward the center. And from them, we know that the sun orbits faster in its center than its poles, about 25 to 29 days. The sunspots are cooler, they're dense magnetic fields. And I mentioned to you that the cycle begins at the poles and moves toward the center because of the solar dynamo. And these sunspots tell us about the frequency, the oscillations in the center of the sun. With these oscillations, we can probe the interior of the sun, where there is a huge dynamo rotating, convecting, and electrically conducting fluid or plasma inside the sun that maintains its magnetic field and its dynamic activity. We can't see them, but we can tell them because of these oscillations and these frequencies. And they are acoustic waves. This turbulence, this plasma, is resonating acoustic waves. So literally, the whole sun is ringing like a bell. And this is the field of stellar seismology or helioseismology that teaches us all about the dynamics. These beautiful images are mapping the dynamic pulse, the heartbeat of the sun that we live and move and breathe with. So with solar telescopes, SOHO, TRACE, STEREO, they've actually made this into sound. And at the very end, I will play for you the beautiful calming sound that our sun is making in a in an audible frequency that we can listen to. And you can find them at Berkeley and Stanford and different places. You can listen to the sun or just find it on YouTube. So the composer, Robert Alexander, has also done a beautiful video using the sun to make music that he created with JPL NASA. And I highly recommend it. I mentioned it before in some of my other talks. It's a wonderful experience to see how they're taking music and integrating the data. And they're understanding things they can't see, but they can hear about our sun. So it's important to know that we eat and breathe and we live sun life. The sun causes the photosynthesis with carbon dioxide and water inside each plant. It sends off oxygen that we breathe. This process with chlorophyll, the oxygen that we breathe is a byproduct. We all eat plants or animals. Animals eat the plants. So literally this whole process of photosynthesis, it's the balance of life's biodiversity on a living planet. We live, we breathe, we are the breath, the living breath of the sun. So in about 5 to 7 billion years, our sun, all stars live and die like everything else in our universe. About 5 to 7 billion years, our sun will explode as a beautiful planetary nebula throwing off its outer shells. It's not big enough to be an actual supernova, but it will throw off these outer shells and create some gorgeous, beautiful nebula. I was looking at names of the sun. And so these are many boys' names and girls' names, and they're all interchangeable. And just mentioning a few, Aditya in Sanskrit, Helios in Greek. Kala, my name actually means the sun in Hawaiian, which I like a lot. So you can find names for your children of the sun if you like. So these are some of our sun gods. We are not just, we're integrating our philosophy and our spirituality and our all our understandings. So we have up here the Celtic sun goddess, which is beautiful.
Ooh, Kala, I think you froze.
Ah, okay.
There we go.
Let me see the sun goddesses. What do you see now?
Yes.
Let me see the sun goddesses and gods.
Okay. Freezing. Are we still here?
Yes, you're here. I think you stopped sharing your screen.
Okay, yes, the connection went off for a moment. Let me go back. Okay, that, can you see it again?
Not yet. But if you share what you shared before, we should see it again.
I am sharing it. Is it working?
Not yet.
Okay, let me try this. Is coming and going. I'm so sorry. Let me do screen share again.
If there's a problem, Kala, we could just continue next time.
Here we go. Here it is.
Here we go. Now we got it. Yeah, now we got it.
All right, let's keep going. So in Lakota mythology, Anapo, this reminds me of what Lynn was saying, Anapo about Venus and Mars. Anapo was a spirit with two faces. She represented the dawn, and she was said to dance with Han, the spirit of darkness. Their dance prevented we, the sun god, from burning up the earth. So these are Native American images and Hittite, the sun goddess. So many images have female images of the sun for the deity, and some have the masculine. We have our Kyrie, we have the feminine Christ and the masculine Christ, and this amazing image of the goddess with the sun as her being here and the rising or the setting sun in her heart. And this one is from Le Sacre Coeur in Paris, which is one of my favorites of the Radiant Christos. So sun temples of the world, the Egyptian, the Greek, the Italian, many, many Indian sun temples still intact, and of course, Stonehenge. So Ireland and the sun, every winter solstice, the rising sun shines through a small aperture in the structure and travels 10 meters into the main chamber, flooding it with brilliant light for around 17 minutes. And this was created around 3,200 BC, New Grange in Ireland, and the sun god there, images. We can see five planets parade in the night sky this month. Venus and Saturn are standing out. So we're in a unique time of the stars being available, the planets being available to our eyes. And I'm wanting to close with a lovely poem that I just found, this beautiful image of the sun and the seismology, the mapping of the movement, the flux of the sun. It's called Solar Heartbeat by Catherine Allen. Upon our little spinning rock, cosmic rays and debris knock. Through great fields and waves we race, not empty our broad path through space. We touch long fingers from afar, energy from our bright star. A fusing, roiling dynamo, magnetic fields induced by flow. 11 currents round our wheel, her heartbeats, pulses, we can feel. In search of answers, models run, probing rhythm of the sun. So we have Venus transiting the earth. This little tiny dark dot here is Venus that crossed the face of the earth in 2012. And Venus here with the sun in her heart, birthing life itself. So that is our slideshow. And I turn it back to.
Thank you. Thank you, Kala. Thank you so much. So much wisdom. Such a dance of opposites is our world, this dance of beauty and deep, profound wisdom and amazingness, and so much treachery and cruelty.
It's shocking that in the light of the life of the sun, such things the human race can perpetrate. But life itself is so powerful. And we have the idea that every ray, every soul comes on a ray of the sun, from the universe, from the stars to the sun, from a ray of the sun. Life itself, the flux of souls flows on these rays.
Beautiful. In the Zoroastrian tradition, one of the highest stations for a human being is to completely surrender and become the ray of the sun. That's so beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. Jim, would you like to make any comments?
Yes, thank you so much, Kala. You know, one quick question that I have is about the relationship between the 11-year cycle of the sun flares and human history, because as you know very well, and this is what I'd like you to comment on, as the sun flares increase, so do wars, turbulence, but also human genius increase.
Yes.
And then when the sun flares decrease for the next 5.5 years, you know, things begin to calm down. And right now we're on an escalating sun flare activity, which peaks around 2025, 26. Is that correct? And just make a comment on that, because I'm thinking about, you know, what Banafsheh was sharing around Iran and what we're all witnessing day by day with the escalation of war in Ukraine and the possibility of nuclear exchange. So what is your understanding of that relationship between human affairs and history and the rise and fall of the solar flares?
So one very brilliant Russian scientist, and I'm not remembering his name right now, please excuse me, I mentioned it in one of my other presentations, did extensive research, geophysics and solar physics. He worked on and found these correlations. And at first he was disregarded in the era he was living in scientifically, but now he's come to, they've found these patterns and it's mapped in historical research that they do correlate. Even the Renaissance was at one of these great peak activities of the sun as we find this. So great cultural dynamics, it's more energy and whatever is there is expressed to a greater degree at the peak energy. There's more energy flowing to the sun, from the sun to the earth. So it's accelerated. And in the quiescent time, it's more calm. There's less intense energy flowing to the earth. So we follow those patterns and it's the 11-year cycle and it goes and follows that from the poles to the center of the sun. And we are now in that quiescent going up again. We've just passed the quieter time in 2020 and it's been going up since then. So we'll see what it brings, the goodness, the beauty, the truth, and as well as whatever tensions we have, all of it is brought up with more intensity as more energy. That's also the reason at the full moon, there's more energy because the moon itself is not a dynamic life, but the energy from the moon is completely reflecting the sun. So the reason we have more energy at the full moon is because we have more sunlight being reflected to the earth by the moon as well as the sun. So it's increasing the energy. It's definitely correlated. And I can find that the research in Russia is especially, they've created a whole museum to him and his research fairly recently.
I think it was Alexander Krzyzewski, right?
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah, Alexander Krzyzewski, around the beginning of the 20th century, who was a physicist, and he noted that during the First World War, the brutality of battles was affected by the solar flares. Yes. That when there was a bright flare, more people were killed, there were more bloody accidents and so forth and so on. And that triggered in his scientific mind the analysis. As I remember it, Kala, you know, he tracked back then about 2,500 years and really showed that what you just said, that the more intensity of light, the more dynamic human affairs. And it's one of the things we could just note. He also said at the lowest point, that's when pandemics and infectious spreads often happen in human society. So the fact that we got the COVID pandemic right at the nadir point of the solar flare is consistent with Krzyzewski's theories.
It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. Yeah, it's amazing because sometimes we think, oh, I'm doing this, or I feel this, or this is just my mood. And we don't realize that the whole universe is flowing through our body, our psyche, our humanity, our whole earth, and everything that we're living in. We move and breathe to all these dynamic pulses and energies and the music of the universe.
Yeah. And just think, everyone, and this is just the final comment I'd like to make, have you make, Kala, on this. It was because it was Pythagoras who intuited, without any of the scientific knowledge that Kala has just laid out, that this was in fact the case about the sun, that it was a bell, and that the rays of the sun were actual sonar frequencies. And the sonar frequencies was what helped shape the solar system, bring it into order, and actually govern life. It's such a fascinating thing that a man 2,600 years ago in ancient Greece, who had no telescope, but he could actually sit so quietly that he could hear the sun, he could hear Mars, he could hear Jupiter, and he could tell that they had different sound waves that they emitted, and that human beings were tuning forks, actually, if you think about us at a very basic level. Just in closing, what would be your comment on that?
So, yes, we can all sit and listen to the universe. When I traveled in the Himalayas, and even in Australia, or when you go to the outback and when it's dark and your mind, there's no wall. In Pythagoras, yes, also in ancient India, in ancient China, these knowledges are there in the ancient cultures, the ancient Egyptian cultures, the ancient Persian cultures, in the Zoroastrian traditions. There's that wisdom, but especially in the Asian traditions. The Buddha said there are more worlds than grains of sand on all the beaches of the earth. And I know the minds of all the beings who live in all these worlds. And it's like you're going, what? Because there's no wall between us, and there's no boundary between us and the music of the universe, the music of the stars, the galaxies, the planets, and each and every one of us. The Buddha could sit, and the Jain teachers, these people, even the gentleman who I know that I've been working with, and my own experience was that you can go out into the universe with your mind, because our mind has no boundary. Our heart has no boundary when we open it, and we can participate in the awareness that we are a particle of the universe, just like every cell in our body. And we can hear, we can move, we can live and move more in harmony. Each of our organs in the Ayurvedic tradition, it says each organ eventually is like a microcosm of a cosmic identity. And our being is a little universe. We're like seed universes that as we awaken, each organ, each system in our body resonates to a cosmic dynamic or identity. And we eventually evolve into a planetary consciousness, a solar consciousness, a universe, a galaxy, who knows? These teachings are there in the ancient wisdom. And for us to awaken to them and have an integration of the science of the broader understanding of evolution itself in a spiritual and cosmological sense is profound and exquisite, because then we participate in more life. We can participate in the music of the sun, of the planet, of the universe.
Kala, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Banafsheh, any comment you want to make before we move on?
No, just enjoying all this amazing wisdom that you're sharing, Kala. Thank you.
And we'll have Kala back, everyone, because I think there's a lot more that you can say. That's clear that you're just the fountainhead of knowledge on this. And what I love about your presentations, Kala, is it blends the cosmological research of science with the mythological intuitive understanding of the world spiritual traditions, because I think that is so important for us to be able to hold the most advanced science with the most ancient insight. So thank you for sharing that. And you know, before we move on, I want to introduce Paula Petry here for in a moment to talk about our youth program. But before we do that, Banafsheh, I just want to say how profoundly moved I was by your presentation. You know, and it just to think about what's going on in that country, in the brutality of the repression of a regime that is consuming its own children in an absolutely blasphemous way, is kind of hard to take in. And so I just want to acknowledge you as a Persian and an Iranian, and acknowledge the sorrow you must be holding in your heart as events unfold, and just support you and all the people in Iran that are striving so courageously for a better world. So I just want to acknowledge that. It was a powerful, powerful statement. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jim. Thank you. Just to add, everyone, you know, in our circle, where we are so reverential, just to add that the regime charges teenagers, 14-year-olds, with moharebe, which means waging war against God. This is happening in our world right now. And the people who have been hanged have been charged with this, waging war against God. You know, the people who've been hanged have been 22, 23, 38. But you know, charging 14-year-olds with waging war against God, where does that come from? They're the ones waging war against any God that I know.
Totally. So thank you for bringing this to our attention. Dear friends, we want to turn to just one final note before we close our session, and that is an initiative coming from one of our dearest colleagues in our community, Paula Petry, who had this idea of developing a youth program for Chartres, something we've thought about for like ever, but we've never been able to get our act together to actually do it, with the exception of some isolated youth that ended up coming. So Paula's got a plan, and she's actually making it happen, and young people are being identified and signing up. So Paula, take 5 minutes and just give us an update and tell us what's happening.
All right. Thank you so much, Jim. And just happy birthday to start with. And just thank you for bringing this brilliance of people expressing such deep wisdom every day in Humanity Rising and through the Chartres community. Very honored to be part of it. And Banafsheh, heartfelt. As I close today, I'm on my way to Seattle for my third Women Life Freedom protest. A dear, dear friend from decades. And she's Iranian, and we both live here. And that's what we do. This is our third protest together. And I feel like I go in support of her as much as the movement, because the grief is so deep. And the anger, no, because it's so irrational that at sunrise, and they put on the prayer song that goes at sunrise, and you felt the entire crowd just to cringe, because that has taken on the meaning of the hangings that happened at that time of day, and the two men that were hung last week. So thank you for bringing that to us. And I will say, I hope it's correct in that the Iranians are holding on to the hope that the world will notice enough that they will, that it will intervene and stop the cruelty. So as much as anyone and everyone can do what their part is to have the world know that we're making note, and we are completely stand against the brutality that is going on. It's exciting as well, just that juxtaposition, as Kayla so brought us to mind, of the juxtapositions of life, and to think of the pulse and the music of the sun and bringing that knowledge and that wisdom to youth. In 2019, preparing actually my course for Ubiquity on Regenerative Grief, I looked at eco-grief. And there it began, my heart just opening to the youth, as 46% of youth stated that their lives are interrupted by the stress caused by the climate change. 66% feeling hopeless, helpless, right? Because adults don't seem to be able to do anything about it. Most recently, the statistics on 20% of high schools in the United States have serious thoughts of suicide, and 9% have actually attempted suicide. So it's important in the context of what we're doing for youth this summer. Schools are waiting for things to return to normal, but we know, everyone here, that normal is not going to happen. We are not returning to normal. So in that context of empowering youth of who they are and connecting the inward with the outer is critically important. And I'm so happy to be a part of bringing that and this to Ubiquity. It affects everyone. But our message at Ubiquity this summer is that as they enter this non-ordinary, unordinary time and space, because everybody who's been at Chartres knows that we enter into this unordinary world. it is the hero's journey. And the hero comes back to give the gifts forward, right? And that is the huge transformation in and of itself for the individual, but for all of those who impact. So yes, we're capping it this year at 20, but we know that the impact of the youth going forward as they impact their other siblings, perhaps their family, community, and schools is going to be tremendous. Just in pulling up a screen share, if I can make this happen. And it may not be necessary, but let me see. All right, okay, there we go. I want you to just, this is what came to me. I wanted to give it deep contemplation after last month's amazing presentation by Chloe Goodchild about the upcoming Charts experience for all of us. And so we are creating this Ways of Love for Youth. And just with this image, generally, just gently close your eyes. Imagine that you're in Charts if you've been there before, if not, that what you will be. And I what came to me was a metaphor for music, because it is musica that we will be focusing on this year at Charts. And imagine a musical instrument, your favorite, and in interpreting the metaphor. If our body is like a musical instrument, our mind is the musician. For the musician to be able to play quality music, he, she, they must come into resonance with the instrument, to know it, to love it, to understand it, what its needs are and how it works. In doing so, he, she, they discover their music, the music that runs deep within, this lifetime's imprint carried by the soul. They then walk in rhythm. Together in harmony, they produce beautiful music. However, if they realize they're actually playing in an orchestra, in the quantum, a grand attunement occurs, and this attunement creates magic. And in this place of magic, synchronicities, ease, and flow are the norm. And that's what we hope for the youth this summer. To be a little bit more specific in terms of what they will be experiencing while participating in the central program, the youth, everyone, will be learning about and experience the power of sound, of music, to tune our bodies, to reset, creating balance and harmony within themselves and resonance with the cosmos. Everyone is going to have that experience. But while in the program, in the youth program, which are about 50% of the time, the youth will learn and experience the potency of living in the state of attunement. They will have direct experiences of their mind having impact beyond themselves, the impact of mind on matter, and having that direct experience. And how weird. And we'll be working with Peter Mary on the weird project, more to come on that. But how this weird, how could that happen? Isn't that weird that that happened? Actually becomes the norm as they live attuned. And they will examine the possibility that we are actually instruments of the cosmos, represented so well in Kyla's presentation this morning. They'll learn additional ways to attune their bodies. That will be shared, that will be learned and taught, and ways varied, the modalities that we know that work, of course, the 5.5 breath being one of them, but several others, and modalities that they can continue to use going forward. And they'll include shamanic energy medicine. There'll be energy transmissions, dance, and other modalities. We will have an offsite excursion, and about 50% of their overall time will be together as youth. And we already have youth, as Jim mentioned, we already have youth signed up, and we're capping it around 20. So spread the word. I believe the energy that coalesces with an intergenerational experience is palpable. A shared worldview. And mostly parents go off to have that experience. Youth are not having that experience, 12 to 18 year olds, very little opportunity. And grandparents. But then to bring that together, because then we have a a set of precepts that are not only guiding one segment of the family's life, but everyone's. So this is what we are striving for, is this shared experience, this shared awe about life and how it is that we are part of the cosmos, so eloquently, deeply experienced today in the presentations, and how it is that by finding that peace within, what we witness in the world can really come to an end. Thank you.
Thank you, Paula. Thank you for your passion. Thank you for your commitment. Someone was asking about the age range, and I put in the chat teenagers, but also 20-somethings is generally what we're looking for, right?
Absolutely. The youth group will be teenagers, and then there will be decisions by parents and the 20-something-year-olds, you know, where they want to flow. You know, we're leaving that that flexibility for those in their 20s, recognizing that for the youth, the abstraction and the content will be more challenging, and the shared experiences in that age group is exceptionally powerful. So absolutely. Good.
Thank you so much. You might put your email in the chat. Yes. So people can be in touch with you, although everybody can be in touch with me as well. And Paula will be back over the next several months to give updates and so forth. So I think that just about brings us to a close. One thing before Banafsheh gives us our benediction is I just want to say that tomorrow, Monday and Tuesday on Humanity Rising, I'll be talking more about the conflict in Ukraine. As you all know, we have a escalating situation over there. There's an increasing danger of nuclear exchange. And we all have to really understand that we need to bring peace. We need an immediate ceasefire. We need a summit. So I'll be talking very deeply about the situation in Ukraine in the spirit of a teach-in, like we used to do around the Vietnam War. So that's tomorrow and Tuesday on Humanity Rising. And I hope you can all come. But Banafsheh, thank you again so much for bringing us into the grief around Iran. And why don't you close us out with a benediction?
Thank you. And thank you, everyone, for what you're putting in the chat. Thank you so much. In closing, as instruments of the divine, emulating the Great Mother, may we develop the capacity to truly hold both the injustice and how it needs to end now, and the joy, the beauty and goodness of being here in this present moment, letting the beauty and the goodness inform and guide us. May we reside in the beauty, goodness and truth, where we can receive guidance as how to act in the face of injustice and abject cruelty, as messengers of love, rays of the sun, realizing that being a human being is a scale, a balancing act, balancing opposites, not turning away from the pain and not losing sight of the joy of simply being alive, but holding them both in this creative moment that is our life. Thank you. So much love to you.
Thank you, Banafsheh. Thank you, Kala. Thank you, Paula. Thank you, everyone. Welcome to 2023. We'll see you next month. It's always the second Sunday of each month that we gather. On the 21st of this month, in a couple of weeks, we have Lynn's astrology workshop. We'll keep you posted on Iran. We'll keep you posted on Ukraine. And all of us begin our preparation for gathering in Chartres this July 2nd through 8th, which is going to be followed by a pilgrimage down to the Dordogne and the Neolithic caves. Thank you, everyone. Bye for now.
Happy birthday, Jim.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.